Good morning. My name is Leslie Abash, and I'm the Director of Human Services for the City of Fairfax. Today, we're going to be going through an information session about the nonprofit grant program that we have just put out on the streets last week. So we will go through this process, I mean, go through the slides, give you an overview. Those of you that have been on the website, there's a web page with the City of Fairfax website that has it will have this PowerPoint after this after this meeting. We're also recording this, and we have a guidance document that has information about the nonprofit grant program. And there's also a way to get a hold of me if you have questions, because there is a period of time that we'll be taking questions and answering those and posting them up. A lot of your questions may be answered by the time we get to the end of the slideshow. So if you have one, ask us. But if it's something that you think we might hit toward the end of the slideshow, if we can wait to the end, that'd be great. All right, on that note, so our overview is going to be program description, the grant categories, area need, eligibility criteria, budget and required documents, application content, how we're going to score it, and the process and the timeline. So why is the city doing this? This is a statement that was made when we initially engaged council about the nonprofit grant. It really is, we understand how our nonprofits really do a lot of work in our city to help our residents and to just enhance our community. And so this is a way of us being able to partner with folks that are doing work already in our city, and help either expand programs or have new programs. And our hope is that this will, every year we'll get funding for this, and we'll even expand the funding to be able to do this on a regular basis, not just a one time. But we do really appreciate what each organization that's on this call today, what you do for our city residents. We couldn't do it without you. All right, so the nonprofit grant program. In FY25, we have $300,000, that was obligated by the mayor and council during our budget process for this nonprofit grant. And we have two different categories. There's mini grants, or there's the regular nonprofit grant. And you can only submit one application. So that means that not an organization can't go, "Hey, I'd like a mini grant, and I'd also like a nonprofit grant." So you only can submit one application for this specific grant program. The mini grants are for the purpose of capacity building or for small-scale innovative ideas or projects. Applicants can ask between $5,000 and $10,000 for this category. And we have $25,000 in this category. So one of the things, just to remind you as we're going through this, $300,000 is the cap of what we have to give out. So that's why this is a competitive process. We only have $100,000 to give out. We have $25,000. So when we're doing the review of what the applications we get, there may be folks that you may apply this year and not get funding. But just keep that in mind, is because of the limits on the money we've gotten. But our hope is that we will continue to have this, and we will have more funding in the future. So in the mini grant application, you have to provide the basic information about your background, your mission, your need for service, the project description of what you're wanting to use your $5,000 to $10,000 for, budget, and two performance measures within the areas of need. And you have to meet the financial obligation or requirements outlined in the nonprofit grant. And if you go on the website, there's a link. You could submit your application electronically, and it prompts you the questions, and it gives you the different areas that you need to provide us information on. But it's important that When you're doing this, you're really thinking about the four different eligibility types and how what you're asking for fits into that, and how you're going to be able to show the impact the funding gave, not just for your organization, but for the community. So beyond the mini grants, we have the nonprofit grant program. And that we have, since we have $300,000, 275 is going to be for the nonprofit grant process. So those nonprofit grant requests will range anywhere from $10,001 to $50,000. And they're to be used to develop, expand, or enhance services within the city of Fairfax to help, improve quality of life by addressing one or more of the defined areas of need. And you must complete an application and provide us all the information we're requesting of you. And again, as we go through it, we'll talk a little bit more about the performance measures, like it's not just to ask for the money, but to really help us to be able to tell the mayor and council, you gave us these funds, we gave them to this nonprofit, and this is what they were able to do with it. Not only does that help, just with accountability of the funds now, it also helps us make the pitch for this program to continue and for us to get to more additional funds in the future. Okay, the area of needs. So to be eligible, you have to f your the nonprofit your nonprofit has to have a program or something that they're wanting to use the funds for that fit into for one of these four areas of need. And as you see, they're fairly broad in the language. So you just need to be able to tell us how you fit into one of these categories. And the first one's prevention and self-sufficiency, and that's services focused on assisting individuals and families in becoming or remaining independent and stable, or providing tools, skills, strategies, and resources to individuals and families. So that could be literacy education. That could be, something you're doing to help somebody get employed. It's ways to work with residents to help them be able to stabilize their situation or improve their life. The second is crisis intervention and diversion. Services provided to individuals and families in crisis to overcome immediate problems and reduce or prevent the need for more restrictive and expensive higher level services. This includes homelessness prevention services. So in this could be, where your program, what your if your program is providing, for instance, you're helping with rent assistance for somebody that's at risk for being evicted. And maybe you work for the with the county and the homelessness continuum, and you're just wanting to add some additional service to what you're already doing. Or it could be that, when somebody is able to get services through the county, get housing assistance, you help them set up their house. Maybe your nonprofit provides furniture or provides access to things that we may take for granted, but we know you need to set up a household. I mean, those are just some examples. Long-term support, those are services that focus on existing individuals who have continuing long-term support needs to remain healthy, safe, and independent in the community. In those categories, it may be that you have a independent living program that you're working with, and there's a specific if you could have some funds to help folks that are living in your independent living program, then you could do it through this long-term support. And then improve quality of human services. Services and opportunities provided to individuals, organizations, and communities that enhance quality, accessibility, accountability, and coordination of services provided by community organizations. And again, these are pretty broad. I think that there's a lot of things that could fit in this. And I mean, If anybody has questions on any of these, we can definitely talk more about. Does anybody have, are there any questions? Okay, so I'll keep going. Eligibility criteria. And this is like one of the most important slides in here. The applicant organization must be located within the city or currently serving City of Fairfax residents. And the funds that you get through this has to go directly to assisting city residents. So the thing that's important about this, if let's say that you don't have a presence, you're not currently working in the city, but you were just thinking, oh, it'd be kind of fun to be in the city of Fairfax, or I think that I could, my organization could really help the city of Fairfax. If you're not already in the city right now, if you're not already doing work, you're not eligible for this funding. This funding really is for people that are already established, organizations that are already established and working in the city. This is not to develop or create new programs. Your mission must be consistent with the city's areas of need. So those four the last slide, you've got to fit into one of those areas. You must be a 501c3 nonprofit through the IRS at the time of submission. And you must submit a complete application. So the funding that we're asking, I mean, the information we're asking for in the application, all the different points in the application where there's questions and there's information asked, you must fill that out to the entirety to be eligible. Because that information, we need that information to make the decisions. So financial, and we're going to talk a little more. JC is with us, and he'll talk a little more about the financial piece of it. But this is just going over some of the points. So I'm going to go over this, and later in the slideshow, you'll get more details. So one of the things to show your financial stability is, do you have to have the IRS 990 forms for the last 3 years and other financial documentation? So that means that, this funds are to enhance or help you create something additional. It's not to, to come in and let's say that you really are a program, I mean, an organization that's struggling and you need these funds to keep the doors open. We really want and require you to already be financially stable when you had these resources. Because one of the things is, with any nonprofit, it's important to be sustainable. And we don't know from year to year if the city will have money to put into this nonprofit grant program or we'll continue doing it. So it's important, again, that your organization is already viable and financially stable before you ask for these funds. And you must be in good standing with Virginia State Corporation Commission at the time of submission and through funding. And you have to comply with this law around, public funds and churches or houses of worship. And this link here, I will, post this. It'll be, but this is really about faith-based organizations, and there's parameters around what you can use public funds for. And I won't get into details today on it, but that is, you will have this copy of this link, and then if you have questions, you can submit them to us, and we can have a further conversation with you. We need a detailed budget breaking a cost. Any organization, I mean, you could ask for $50,000, but we really need to know what you're going to be using that $50,000 for before we make the decision to obligate those funds to you. And the show and efforts by organizations to secure funding from other sources, this goes back again to the sustainability and you being financially stable while you're asking for the funds. Because these funds are not meant to be the only funding for a program. Anybody that's applying, we are assuming that you already have some other funding mechanisms. And again, this is only going to add and allow you to maybe expand or do something that you don't have money directly available for. But at the same time, you do have an operating budget and you are, able to do business even if you didn't get these funds. Programmatic. documented data-driven need for organization, program, or service. Really, in your when you're answering your questions in your application, it can't, be, well, we thought think this will be a good idea to have an ice cream store for our residents. You really have to say why. Why do you feel like this program and service will impact the community? And any of you on this that have asked for grants, like if you get them through the Fairfax County's a grant process, or you've gotten maybe ARPA money, or you've gotten CARES Act money, or just different funding sources, this shouldn't be new to you, having to justify what you're asking for. And we want, to know what the outcomes are. So how do we know that what was done has made an impact? And that really helps us out with city council and us, saying, hey, look at, we had six organizations that got these funds, and look what they did. Look how they positively impacted the community. So this is real important, not only from the oversight mechanism of, us knowing where the money's going and how it's impacting, but also for us to be able to report back to mayor and council and say, it made a difference that you obligated these funds. And again, the enhancing the quality of life for city res. I mean, that's kind of the overall theme. There's got to be a positive impact for the city of Fairfax residents if you receive these funds. Administrative, and I think this goes back to something I talked about earlier. You have to already be an existing, obviously, if you're a 501c3, there's requirements to be a 501c3. So it, you have to be able to say, hey, we've got these administrative resources that we can do all these things that you're asking us to do with these funding. We can oversee, and we can, provide the reporting. We can, make sure that we're compliant. I mean, you have to, be able to show that you have that infrastructure to use these funds. And we will have an MOU for any funds that are obligated. And that just is something that it lays out, what the, I mean, there's a lot of legalese that goes into any of those MOUs. And you've probably seen them before if you've had any kind of MOU with the local government. And it, but it also just says this is what, it'll the scope of service will be what you proposed to us, that you said we're going to do, A, B, and C with these funds, and that will be a part of that MOU where, we're both clear as you're moving forward. This is what your plan is, and this is what we require, of you to receive those funds. And you'll see here this theme again. It's the, this you're not, you're, we're really wanting you to show that you're able to do business and do the work that you're doing, even if you didn't have these resources. So that's important when we're looking at your applications, and also for your eligibility, that we see that you have, that this money's just only going to enhance what you're doing. It's not, but it's not going to be something that ensures that you're able to do business. All right, and so these are some more about data-driven. I know that depending on what your organization does, these don't have to be these really detailed things, but they do have to be data points that tie into what you're doing. Where if you're doing a specific outreach, where you have a data point that shows if we make this outreach to these residents and we offer this service, this is how we know that it was successful, or this is what our end goal is. So we, kind of thinking through how you can show that, like what data you're going to be tracking for the reports we're getting, and then, how you're going to show in the end the difference or the impact it made to be able to have the funding. Okay, application content. I'll stop a minute. Was there any questions?
Leslie, there's one, Kathleen has a question from Salvation Army.
Okay, Kathleen.
I was just wondering if the grant guidelines was going to be something that was going to be updated on the website, so this information would be available after the webinar.
Yeah, it's already, the guidance document's already on the website, but I'm also going to post this PowerPoint after I finish today.
Okay, yeah, because The link to the grant guidelines actually shows up as unavailable on my end, so I wasn't sure if
Yeah, it was not working earlier in the day, but you should be able to get to it now. I just tested it before. But just reach out to me if you're having problems with it.
All
But
right.
we
Yes, ma'am.
realized that earlier that it wasn't working.
Okay, yeah, I'll check again in an hour and I'll email if anything. Thank you so much.
Yeah, and just reach out if you're still having problems with it, because
All
we
right.
definitely want everybody to have access to this information.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. And also on that web, the web page, any questions we get from an organization, we will answer it in writing, and we'll post it up so that everybody gets to see what the questions are. So that will be a really important thing for you to check out, to see if other stuff has been posted. One of the things we'll talk about at the end, there's a timeline. So there's a timeline for answering questions. So we won't post every question anytime it gets answered, but we will post it by the deadline where we have it all, listed what the question was, but also what our answer was, where everybody has access to that as you're completing your application. So the next part, we're just going to go through the different parts of the online application. And the guideline document really goes through each part, and it has questions that prompt you of what we're looking for. So today I'm just going to go through an overview. I'm not going to really get down into the weeds because that information is available to you. But just like I previously said, if there's any clarifying questions, please feel free to reach out to us where we can, help answer that, where you if there is something that you don't understand or you just want clarification for. So with this, each section includes specific questions that'll prompt you of what we're asking for in that section. You can, I just talked about the guidelines for posting on the website. And this is real important. It's critical that you're giving me information or giving us information about the organization, what you're currently doing in the city of Fairfax. Because if you remember earlier when I said this is a really important slide, we need, for you to say, this is what we're doing in the city right now. This is, or this is how long we've been established in the city. This is what we've previously done. This is the population we're working with. Showing documentation that you're already established and working in the city. And you must submit a fully completed application, because one of the things, I just want to warn folks about is that I'm not going to go through applications until, the end date. Like when we pull those applications and I get them ready for our panel to review them and for us to determine, who's going to have awards. At that point is when we're going to really open up your application. So it's really up to each of you to make sure that your applications are completed. The only thing that may, like the financial piece of it, if there's concerns up front, you might get feedback before the applications close, or right soon after the application closes. But we're not looking in and making sure that you've put everything in there and you put all the required documents. So please, please, please do that. Because I would hate if you had an awesome idea and you really, had it really planned out and scoped, and you skip sections, because I mean that's going to disqualify if we don't have the information. So please take the time to go through and make sure that you give us, all the required information. So these are supplemental, and I don't know, JC, do you kind of want to talk through these next slides, and I
I
can be
can.
your Vanna? Okay. Just
Thank you,
tell me when you're
Leslie.
ready for me to move to the next slide, okay?
Sure. So I'm JC Martinez. I'm the Chief Financial Officer for the city. Worked very closely with Leslie and other department heads as well and directors to try to make sure that we can put this together for you all. So on this slide, just very quickly, as Leslie sort of stated, we are requesting some of your most recent financial statements, at least for the last 2 years, that have been audited by your outside auditor. Also asking for your organization's current operating budget, has also previously stated that IRS 990 form for the past 3 years, the IRS letter of designation saying that you are a full-fledged nonprofit, certificate of good standing with Virginia, a current W-9. So in the award, in the event that we do award to your organization, then we already have that. We can set you up as a vendor and make sure that we're tracking you accordingly in our financial system. Your unique entity identifier, also known as the UEI, and then the financial statements, which if they're a part of your audited financial statements, which they usually are, your balance sheet, your income statement, and your cash flows, those are usually a part of your financial statements. If for some reason they're not, then if you could provide those to us and they'd be as most current as you have available, that would be greatly appreciated. Next slide. In addition to some of these required items, see if Leslie can help me here a little bit. So just current listing of your board directors and key staff, this would sort of help us make the lines to the dots of who's sort of running the organization, what these positions are, based on the organizational chart as well, that has the number of full-time, part-time, and the volunteers, sort of sizing the scope of the organization and the entity as well, any relevant licenses and certifications that each of these key staff members, volunteers, or board directors have, just add extra weight to that grant application. And then, pretty important, the organization's outcome plan connected to the funding request. Part six, specifically on the budget request, at the end of the guidelines, it goes into these specific areas, gives a little bit more detail of what these categories are, some examples as well. But these are the six main categories that we're looking for when you're developing your budget and the narrative of what the funding would go towards, whether it's personnel, fringe, equipment, travel, things of that nature. We'll get to it here in the next slide or so, but also the budget breakdown, and that's how it sort of relates by line item, by category, by hours, by amount as well. And if that can be included, it would help us make a better determination and evaluation when scoring the totality of everything that comes in. And then just please of note, operating costs included in your organization's proposed MPG budget should not exceed more than 20% of the total budget as well.
And JC, one of the things I would say, operating costs, that's, your staffing, your copier, your building, all those costs that to do business.
Correct. So I would go back and refer to the guidelines and the narratives within the guidelines towards the end of these specific categories, the six of them, where that gives the definition of each area or each category. Next slide.
We do have one question
Okay.
from Lynn. Lynn has asked, does Fairfax City have a needs assessment document beyond housing? I have not been able to find one, and the county version does not have city data. So, I mean, we have several plans that you may be able to use. One, of course, is the housing needs assessment that was recently done. But you can also look at our comprehensive plan,
Okay,
which
right down.
has a lot of information as well. We are in the process of completing like an affordable housing and homelessness strategic plan that unfortunately won't be done until sometime next year. So those are the only plans I can think of from an assessment standpoint, JC or Leslie. Can you all think of any other plans that may be beneficial for our nonprofits?
I think you covered them,
Okay, all
Valmarie.
right. Thank you.
Okay, I'd like
There's
to
that
thank.
city. There's that city. What is the thing that our planning does every year of a city
I mean,
data?
that's the fact that there's a fact book that
Right,
we have. Yeah, and that's online.
Okay, thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
I was hoping there was a secret document I hadn't found yet. It's all good.
No,
Thank you.
you're welcome.
The last slide was just an example of the budget template
Yeah, I think
that
so too.
was made available. It's my understanding that that template it's going to just stay in an Excel format. So if it needed to be expanded as in add other columns or rows specifically, you're more than welcome to do that. It's more of a guide. Those red lines or the red information that was listed in there is just an example of how it should sort of flow, what details should be in there. I would go back and just suggest looking at the guidelines specifically relating to the budget narratives within those specific six categories. If you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to either myself or Leslie or the city, and we can try to figure out and work with you. It's a very simplified Excel document. We're not trying to make this complex. We're trying to make it as simple and as easy as possible for both sides, for us and you all. And again, if you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to us and we will do what we can to help you out.
The next section, one of the things that we'll be doing to score the applications is that we'll have a panel, and it'll be me, there's somebody from finance, somebody from parks, somebody from community planning development, economic development, and our Title VI coordinator. So the group of us will get together, and we have a scoring sheet, and you can see it's in the guidance document. You can, and I'll show you the different areas we're scoring on. So you have to make, overall, it's a 100-point scale, and you have to make 100, I mean 75 or more to be eligible for funding. And you really have to. The next thing that says, and it's not mush, it's must, organization must score at least 25. So that means you can't have any of the categories that you don't score anything in. You've got to get at least some points in that to be eligible. So, we use this application score because I know that we're going to get a lot of really good applications. So this helps us choose and prioritize the folks that are going to get the funding. So Nancy, you want to go to the next? So the score, these are the different, the maximum points, and these are things that we're looking at. And as you see, the completeness of application, you get 10 maximum points. But that could also, if you don't give us all the information, that could impact your ability to even be eligible. So make sure you complete that application. The statement of need, that's where you're showing that this is what we're asking for, and this is why we feel like it would be important for the city to pay for, the whatever you're asking for the funds for. We need to know your time frame. So, like, if we give you the money in 3 months, when do you estimate to be able to actually get whatever you're asking for the money for, get it up and running? So we need like the description of what you're going to be doing, but also the timeline. You get 20 points for that. Your organizational background, quality, organizational background qualification expertise. And this really goes back to, we want you to use the expertise that you already have in the work that you're doing. So if you're somebody that does affordable housing work, obviously you're going to be able to show the qualification expertise because you've already been working in this space, and this is just a new program or an expanded program. We want to look at that because that goes back to the sustainability and that you're already working in the business. And I guess, it'd be something like if you're, and I'm going to say lacrosse because I love lacrosse because my kids play lacrosse. So like, what if your organization does lacrosse work and you think, well, hey, maybe we should do affordable housing. That you are not going to really be able to find to show your qualification and background in doing something, outside of what you're already your scope. So we really do want to, see that it matches. Your cost justification. Even if you ask for 50,000, we want, it just needs to make sense what you're asking for when you do those line items. And you get a bonus, 10 points bonus, to align with the city council vision and goals. And those are up on the website. But if you can tie that in, I mean, that again shows that that's not only helpful for us to really figure out the value of what you're asking for, it helps us when we ask for other money, or we ask for the next year's money when we can say to council, and this is how they supported the vision that you have, for the work that you're doing on the dais. All right, so these are some of the milestones. Today's October 3rd, so we're doing the virtual session. So you have to the 14th to submit questions and submit them in what writing to me. You'll see my email address at the end of this. So you submit the questions, and that way, we want to get them by the 14th where we can get those posted where you have them by the 21st as you're finishing up your application, and maybe there's a piece that you can't do until you get those completion. So the application due date, November 4th. So the day before elections, November 4th by 4 p.m., those applications need to be in. Not at 4:01, not at 6:45, but 4 p.m. on November 4th. And we will, close the application, the online portal at that point. And so it's important that you're being planful and that you get that in. I've seen it before, and I'm sure some of you on here that have done, grant proposal in the past. I've seen really good proposals not get funding because they didn't meet the deadline. And you do all this work and you pull it together and you don't get there in time. So just make sure that you get it to us by November 4th at 4 p.m. And then we will, in November, we will do the process we're going to do to decide who gets the funding and get it out by December 10th. Because what our goal is really for you to have, for us to get the award announced in December to work on getting the MOUs and get everything in place where in January you can start doing the great work that you're doing with these funds. So that's our goals. The general tips for application development, I won't read this to you, but just, some of this is just making sure that you're being specific to the city, you're concise, you're directly answering the questions, you're showcasing what you're already doing, because you're already doing some great work, or you wouldn't be sitting here, asking for this, looking at this opportunity. So, take the time to say, hey, this is what we're already doing, and this is what the impact we've already made. And the final reminders, and I think I just already said that, no exceptions about you have to have it here by November 4th, 4 p.m., no exceptions. You have to be a 501c3 and meet the minimum financial standards, and that will be, JC's team will be looking at those financial documents to make sure that you meet the minimum requirements, and that you're currently either in the city serving residents, or let's just say you're right outside the city, your building is, but you're still coming into the city doing work in the city. So on that note, does anybody have any other questions or comments? This would be the time you can ask now, or you can just submit them to us.
I have a couple of questions. I have my 501c3, all of that. I've been working in Fairfax City for a long time, but I don't have a budget. The budget was my budget. The things that I wanted to do, like my back to school, toys for tots, all kinds of things. But it was basically coming out of my pocket. And what I guess I'm trying to ask is it somehow that you can get kind of assistance in doing this? Because I've never done a grant.
So with your 501c3, I would expect that there's certain things that you have to have in place for that. I don't know, JC. Yeah, so do you like track the money that you're putting in to do some of the things you're doing, Vicki?
Yes, I do.
So you keep receipts, you keep
I keep receipts. I have a bank account for my organization separate like that.
Okay. So let's do this, Vicki. I have your email address, because I probably need to connect you with our finance team to, just kind of make sure to see what it is that you have. So let me just connect you, with the finance team after this meeting.
Okay, that'd be great. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Vicki. And I saw another question about, do you receive the funds? Does the grant begin January of 2025 to December 2025?
No. So the we hope to do the first tranche in December, the second tranche in April. And so what we are planning to do is from the point of the approval to be retroactive back to, and I got to remember the date that it was approved. I know it was in September, but we can go back to the date that it was approved by mayor, the program was approved by mayor and council. And so the other question is, so the answer to your question is no, it's going to go until June 30th of 2025. So the other question is, what are the reporting requirements? So your part of your MOU is going to, we're going to incorporate your application and proposal by reference. So the first tranche, there will be, you don't have to do any reporting because you're going to get that almost immediately. The second tranche, before you can get the second tranche of the dollars, you'll have to be able to clearly articulate and show us what you have done with the funds th thus far. You'll have to, go through, what you've spent, because when you request the dollars, you're going to request, the first tranche and what you're going to spend it on. And then when you request a second tranche, you'll have to show us documentation of what you've done with the first tranche. And then before July 30th, you'll have to give us another report on what you did with the second tranche.
Okay, one clarification. So all the money will provided you're okay with whatever the outcomes were on the second invoice. The program then doesn't actually run through the 30th. It has to end before the 30th to report on it by the 30th.
It runs through June 30th.
Okay, so if it
Your
runs
second
through June
report
thirtieth,
is due
but then
July 30th.
you can't report on it on June 30th. You need like another 10 days or something.
Okay, so what I stated, I'm sorry.
No, so I'm just wondering, like, do we need to end it like June 1 so we can report by June 30, or
No, all the funds have to be expended by June 30th. Your report will be due back to us for the second tranche that you'll get in April by July
so
30th.
basically two reports and then by July. Okay. Thanks. I was just double checking on that.
No worries. So if you think of any other questions that you may have, you have until October 14th to send those questions to Leslie. You put them in writing. We'll answer all of the questions in writing, and we'll either post them and send them out. We have a separate web page on the site, so we'll post them by the 21st. So after the 14th, we won't take any more questions that, general, questions. If you're having issues with submitting your application or something like that, something comes up, you'll be able to contact us directly. But there will be no exceptions for the deadline because it is a competitive application. So all applications must be in and submitted by November 4th at 4 p.m. So I would admonish you not to wait to the last minute to submit your application. Any other questions? Leslie, turn it back over to you.
Yeah, thank you for thanks for ta your interest, and thanks for taking the time to be on this today. And just reiterate, all this information will be on the web page. Like, there's a guidance document that goes through not only what I went through, but like some of the prompts and the information that you're going to need in the online application. There'll be, we'll put up the questions once we hit the deadline for the questions. So all that information will be available. But do take some time. If you're like me, I usually do some thinking after I've been on one of these, and then I think about three or four questions after I've had some time to think through and re work read through that. So just do that and send that to us, because that just makes sure that we're all on the same page and that you have everything you need to be successful in this submission. So please, do that, and then we share it with everybody, so everybody gets to see some of those questions. So just take the time to do that. Look at any of our documents. And if you find something that just doesn't make sense, ask us the question about it. But I really appreciate it. And so it's Leslie of Ashton, FairfaxVirginia.gov. So just, find me, reach out, send the mess. But we do want you to send the questions electronically. I mean, not electronically, but in writing. That way we can make sure that we see your question and that it's I have it in my hand where I can respond to it. So on that note, I hope you have a good rest of the day and thanks for hanging out.